This is Jack Rice at the United Nations. I'm here with Steve Krause, the chief of the HIV/AIDS branch, again, at the United Nations Population Fund. Steve, again, thanks for coming on with me.
Great to be with you, Jack, and welcome back to the UN.
I look at what it is that you do, and the numbers are so staggering on a worldwide basis. I wonder how you get up every day sometimes. You know what I mean? It's just incredibly difficult. There are so many people struggling with this, and in some places the numbers are going up, not down. Isn't that true?
That's certainly true. I mean, we've been dealing with HIV/AIDS now in the world for the last 27 years, and we've seen some remarkable success stories. We've also seen some remarkable failures and the inability of leadership to really stand up and be accountable to their people, to their citizens, to their communities about what they say they're going to do and what they actually do.
Okay, maybe that's the rub then, isn't it? Everybody's going to say, we want to stop AIDS. Everybody will acknowledge that it's a bad thing. Oh, well, thank you very much for all your help. How do you motivate them to actually follow up after that and say, okay, now what are you going to do about it?
Kind of the strategy we use in the UN, because it's what we've got, it's the armaments that we have in the war chest, is we try and get governments to say the right thing and then hold them accountable for doing what they said they would do. So, for example, in 2001, we had a high-level global General Assembly special session on AIDS here in New York, in which heads of government came to New York and made commitments. Every 2 years, and next week it will be one of those events, we bring those same governments back and hold them accountable for the commitments they made in 2001. It's 2008. What's the progress? We have countries now, 147, that report on an annual basis on how well they're meeting their targets. Sometimes they're exceeding them, and sometimes, of course, they're falling way, way short.
Okay, let's assume that they fall way, way short. When you keep saying accountable, we're going to hold you accountable. Well, holding my children accountable if they don't clean their rooms is one thing, because I can actually do something. They can stay in their room for the day and finish cleaning their room.
Right.
Do you make these countries stay in their room and clean it? I mean, what do you do in terms of accountability other than saying you promised, you're a big fat liar? I mean, what do you do?
Yeah, for the cleaning services, we contract that out here at the UN. But, well, I think what we try and do are a couple of things. One is we try and make sure that civil society gets access to this information, because civil societies, community leaders, religious leaders, local people will hold their governments more and more accountable. When they know that the results of actions taken or not taken by their governments are affecting their local communities in their own backyard, those community leaders are going to challenge and take on responsibility to change the status quo in their own local environment. So that's really important. I think if we've learned anything in 27 years, you must work with community leaders. If you don't, you run a huge risk of being irrelevant, talking all the right things, but no impact if you're not working with the community.
And yet at the same time, there are certain countries in the world. I can take you to Egypt, I can take you to Saudi Arabia, I can take you to parts of Indonesia, I can take you to other parts of around the world where you can be a community leader and the government couldn't care less. So that's your leverage? That's the best you've got?
No, I think we've got other things. That's one of the things that we try and do. I think another key thing that we try and actively do in the UN is promote best practices. So those countries you just mentioned, Egypt, Indonesia, other parts of the world, in almost every country you have what we call best practice or good practices, where the community, in many cases governments too, have really stepped up and are doing remarkable things. For example, in Indonesia today, they're doing things with injecting drug users that would have been impossible to imagine 3 years ago. Now we're highlighting next week the good work that Indonesia is doing on injecting drug users. In Egypt, they're doing some fantastic outreach on the streets of Cairo with sex workers, with people who inject drugs, and men who have sex with men through the local health services that are simply amazing. I mean, they're reaching out to some of the most vulnerable populations in their communities. So we try and say that, hey, if it can be done in Jakarta, if this can be done in Cairo, it can be done in Dakar, it can be done in Johannesburg, and it can be done in Washington. You know, so it's trying to give examples of where people have risen above the rhetoric and are actually doing something remarkable. So holding governments accountable, working with communities, promoting best practices, and then I'd say a third or a fourth or a fifth thing is really making sure that the data is profiled in a public matter. One of the best ways to increase accountability is transparency, making sure that that information is front and center. Anybody who wants it can go to the webpage, find out how does my country compare with our neighbor, and how do our neighbors compare with other parts of the world. That kind of transparency oftentimes, not always, but oftentimes helps build better government and transparency in what governments are choosing to do and choosing not to do.
Are there cultural limitations to this? Specifically, I can think of the Middle East in some places where being gay is illegal. I can think of President Ahmadinejad of Iran, who says there are no gay people in Iran, for an example. Now, being gay and having AIDS, obviously they're not synonymous, but that is one of the issues you have to address. How do you address that?
Yeah, I think one of the things that's really crucial for anybody working in AIDS, but on any of the social and economic challenges facing the world today, is we have to admit that culture matters. You can't deny that culture matters. If you throw it under the carpet and you say that I'm going to ignore culture, I'm going to ignore these crucial factors that are driving the response, and then you do so at your own risk. You have to acknowledge that religion, faith, perceptions, values, culture, traditions matter. So you've got to find those traditions that are supportive and then use those cultures and traditions that are supportive to challenge those that are not. And I think that, for example, in every country in the world today, it's important when they come to the UN next week that they hear the words by the Secretary General, by the President of the General Assembly, by senior officials, the words men who have sex with men, injecting drug use, sex work. These are the kinds of vulnerable populations that, far from being suppressed, they need to have their rights acknowledged and human rights put on the agenda.
But at the same time, there are many people in this country, when you said those things, they'd be squirming right now going, and they'd be looking up at the sky. That's what happens here, and let's contemplate that somewhere else.
You're absolutely right, Jack. And I think that that's the challenge we all face. It's a global response that's needed. You know, I always prefer the UN language today, where they talk about high, middle, and low-income countries as opposed to developed, medium-developed, or low-developed countries. Because, hey, we can have a high-income country that in many, many ways is still being challenged developmentally on some key issues. You know, so you can have people
let me take you to Let me take you to central LA and Appalachia, and I think those people will go, well, someplace, but not here, my friend.
Yeah, exactly. And I think, you know, one of the things, why 27 years after the AIDS epidemic first started, why haven't we made more progress? Denial. People just uncomfortable acknowledging that these effects, these events, these behaviors occur not just in some planet far, far away, and not just some country half away around the world, but right in our own backyard, right in our communities. And until we acknowledge that these things happen and that people are people and they all have the fundamental right as human beings to enjoy sexual and reproductive health, openness, integrity, and respect, until we try and do that in our own local communities, we really won't solve the global AIDS epidemic. What we do in our backyard does matter.
Steve, thank you so much.
You bet. Good to see you, Jack.